Travelogue, number 6.
Budapest, Budapest, der Czodasch. Der vagy nékünk a szív dobogás. Sehol nincs a világon ilyen szép május és ilyen ritmaradás. Budapest, mi nekünk a világ. A Dunát mennyi hív öleli át. Benn az égen a hold és a sok teli bolt. Csoda szép ragyogás. Budapest, Budapest, de csodás.
Hey you, come with me as I get Budapest and hung. Come with me as I get hung. I got off the 169 to Budapest at around noon and walked 30 minutes to my hostel from the Budapest Kaledi train station. But it was absolutely worth it because my hostel was amazing. The Lavender Circus hostel was not only the cheapest hostel for my trip, but by far the coolest. It was decorated with this beautiful line art and it was just everywhere. I was just walking to the check-in area and I was already met with these beautiful pieces which were drawn on with magic marker. It was amazing and I want to live there so bad. Also, it was in the perfect location, nestled in between CD shops and vintage bookstores, and was right across from a museum. To be fair, I didn't go in it, but it seemed really cool from the outside. Also, according to the website, it was first opened in 2007 and was founded by a cat, which is just so gnarly. I checked in, and this was my room. Fit with an ancient couch, these really cool drawings, two beds, one on the first floor and one on the second, stained glass, and these really cool colored lights. And it was just so nice to have the space to myself after the smaller rooms in Vienna and Prague and the shared rooms in Germany. It was just really nice. And as I walked outside to get something to eat, I saw this mural of things to do in Budapest. I only managed to do half of them, but I'll check them out next time. Then, I walked 4 minutes from my hostel to the Vasicharnok, or the Great Market Hall, which I will talk about in a second, but I almost immediately got scammed upon entering. See, I was hungry, having only eaten a pastry and a spezi in Vienna, so I immediately went up to the cafe area and got this stuffed cabbage plate. And keep in mind, I have a very little grasp of the local currency and the local language, and I didn't know that she was upselling me whenever she asked if I wanted a sausage or a pork belly or this white cream sauce or the ajvar, so I said yes to all of them, and ended up spending 14,270 forints, or 40 US dollars, on a plate of food, because for some godforsaken reason, one Hungarian forint is equal to 28% of a penny. To be fair, it was an absolutely amazing meal, and it had more flavor than anything else I had had since maybe the sausage in Nuremberg back in episode 3. Anyway, here have some Trumpex Putin magnets. Look, they're not my OTP, but I don't want to yuck anyone's yums. And like, I get it, everyone has problematic faves, but like, two war criminals? Well, I shit McDonald's. Anyway, the Great Market Hall is the largest and oldest indoor market in Hungary. The market was first dreamed up in the early 1860s, and it took over 30 years to make it a reality, thanks to the architect Samu Pix in 1897. I got a hat for my younger brother and a patch from Budapest for my jacket. Then I went downstairs, which houses all these different local food stands. I looked at all the different meats and sausages, but I doubt I could eat any of them before I left, or that I could even bring one of the huge sausages on the train, besides my own kielbasa. They also had a lot of paprika, paprika paste, and dried bell peppers for some reason. It's almost like it's its main export or something. Then I found a chimney cake stand, and they're called Kertoskelech here, and they're not traditionally filled with ice cream. This one was filled with chocolate, strawberries, and nuts. Then I walked briefly across Szabadság híd, which translates to Freedom or Liberty Bridge, to the other side of Budapest. Because Budapest, like teenagers forced to share a room, split the city down the middle to the Buda and Pest side. And in this analogy, Buda is the older, cleaner, quieter sibling, and Pest is the younger, sloppier party animal who is currently throwing up in the bathroom. It is full of ruined bars and clubs. I decided to stay in Pest. Right across from the bridge, I found this cool church which was carved from the inside of a cave. It is run by the Pauline monks from the Order of St. Paul the First Hermit, and has a statue of the Black Madonna of Częstochowa, Poland, along with a giant Polish chicken, as Hungary and Poland have very strong bonds. Then, I took a brief walk to the top of Gellert Hill as it began to get foggy and dark, crunching leaves as I walked up this ancient hill named of St. Gerald, who was killed by barrel rolling as he tried to forcibly Christianize the local Hungarian population almost exactly 1,000 years ago, give or take a few days and years. It was also used during the Second World War and the Revolution in 56 by the Russians as they fired down bullets upon the city's population. And then they drove them out of the city. And they made a statue for their freedom, a statue of liberty. Ironically, while I was there, the statue was locked up with barbed wire. Then I went to Tesco. There, I got a very mediocre sandwich that I didn't eat all of because it had mayonnaise in it, paprika-flavored chips that were not all that good, water, which was water, and then literally the best liquid I have ever consumed, the best chocolate milk I have ever had, and don't you worry, because this isn't going to be the last time I talk about it. Next morning, I was super excited to explore Pest, so I quickly got a really good breakfast from Zoska's and walked to the Dohan Street Synagogue. I felt a tad strange waiting in line to see a synagogue, despite not being Jewish, but then again, I went to like 50 churches, and I'm not particularly religious, so... Anyway, this synagogue is the largest in all of Europe and is said to be the inspiration for the Central Synagogue in Manhattan. Also, for some reason, the Jewish place of worship was not allowed to be built or designed by a Jewish person, so they decided to bring in some guy named Christian from Germany to design a synagogue in Hungary. And he also said there's no, quote, distinct architectural style, so he used, quote, in architectural forms that have been used by Oriental ethnic groups that are related to the Israelite people, and in particular, the Arabs, unquote. It was consecrated on the 6th of September of 1859, and it was fascinating to learn about the Jewish culture and the history of the place. There was one thing that really stuck with me, and that was that it was God's intention to create the universe not completely finished, in order to allow us to become his partners in perfecting and mending it. I think they were talking about circumcisions, though. From the synagogue, I had a roughly 45-minute walk to my next destination, City Park, with Voiduhunada Castle, which is covered with moss and vines. After exploring this ancient castle that has been around for at least a millennia, or checking my notes, 120 years ago and was originally made out of cardboard and wood, I attempted to find a WC and explore this area of the park some more, which was beautiful, and now realizing it, I think I just really like parks. I mean, the English Garden, the People's Garden, City Park, just... I got a pastry and some old wine, which was pretty good, as I sat by a lake and admired the castle a little bit. But alas, soon enough I had to get the show on the road, So I took some pictures of Szechenyi thermal baths, which was around this area, and I'd fully intended on going to and experiencing, but that would also blow out a few hours, and the idea of being by myself in a swimsuit in some massive hot tub being judged by people in a different country made me feel absolutely nauseous. But the architecture and style was really cool and almost Wes Andersonian, or something else very pretentious. I ended up getting myself some langos, which is this Hungarian fry bread pizza type situation, and it was just so good. It was greasy and garlicky and cheesy. I got it from Legetti Langos, and it was topped with garlic, sour cream, and cheese. And after being fueled with mulled wine and basically a fried pizza, I made my way out of the park, which led me to Hero Square. Hero Square was unveiled as part of the Millennia Exhibition, this giant 1,000-year-old anniversary party for the foundation of Hungary. And in fact, Vojvodina Castle was also unveiled during this time. The exhibition took place in 1896, and each part of the statues at Hero Square is some relic or reference to Hungary's medieval history. Afterwards, I had a long walk to my next stop, which was St. Stephen's Cathedral, which was one of the biggest churches I've ever seen, and it was built on this hallowed ground of a former animal fighting ring, and after this area was used as refuge for a massive flood that overtook Budapest in 1838, people donated to them in thanks for housing them during this time, and they built a church here. It is named in honor of St. Stephen's I of Hungary, the country's first king who Christianized those bloodthirsty pagans by threatening them with torture and even death in some cases. This building was overseen by Kurva. It was overseen by enemy of the channel and the former emperor of Austria, the king of Hungary, Franz Josef Karl I. And in 1845, Josef Hild was appointed to design the basilica, but after some earthquakes and this tiny little war of Hungarian independence, they decided, hey, let's put the patron saint of Hungary on the church instead of some nerd named Leo the Good of that country who just beat up and stole all of their lunch money. So, Hild began working on it officially in 1851, and in 83, they put in an elevator. This church was massive, but it was a lot less busy than others such as St. Vitus. So I got to explore more of it. It was just so impressive and beautiful. It felt so surreal to be in that place. It almost felt holy. Maybe it was the bones. Actually, it was a hand and not a skull, but we love being self-referential here. Or maybe this intense feeling of holiness came from St. Peter and his, St. Peter. I'm sorry, I had to. It's funny. Afterwards, I took the elevator up to see Budapest from above, and I think at this point in the trip, I started to realize that all cities kind of look the same from up above. Not saying that it isn't really cool to see it, and the red roof slap, but like... Afterwards, I began to walk back to my hostel, after realizing that contrary to popular belief, I'm allowed to take breaks and not just collapse on my bed at 6 p.m. and watch TikToks till I pass out, after being on my feet exploring since 8 a.m. in the morning. So, I went to take a bit of a break before I got something to eat and drink, but I smelled something in the air, something sweet, like soft serve. With a doughy casing, and like a bloodhound for chimney cakes, I found myself at some sort of fairground and found a Kurtos Galach with ice cream in it. So I ate it as I walked back to my hostel. After a brief break, I wanted to go to this famous ruin bar, but I think you're not supposed to drink on an empty stomach, so I found the Caravan right next to the place where I wanted to go anyway. The Caravan is this outdoor food court and beer garden loaded with food trucks. It has this really cool environment, and so I decided to get some goulash from a truck. The bread bowl kinda sucked, but the soup was okay. Then I went to the most touristy and popular spot in Hungary, a ruin bar by the name of Szimszla Kurcsomoy. This directly translates to simple garden cinema in Hungarian, and it was built out of a former housing unit and stove factory, and it was saved from demolition because of the bar. Each room has this different theme, and the drinks were cheap, and it was really cool. To quote a tipsy MJ, disco balls, plants, tuss, graffiti, everywhere. Coolest shit I've seen, bro.
Building a gun, playing housing.
I realized after my second drink that I had only ever drank in 3 alcohols in a row before, so I decided to go back to my room, but not before going to Tesco, where I tried to find some sort of snack, maybe something sweet, something savory, maybe a pastry of some sort, and found the literal nectar of the gods for the second time, Miso's chocolate milk. So I picked up some snacks and walked back to my hostel. And there, I collapsed onto the bench and drank some chalky milk, along with some cheesy bread thingy and gummies. And while I was still fairly tipsy, eating all of this lovely food, I watched a video about death. Then I went up and wrote into my journal, and as I record my memories there, let me talk about my Lord and Savior. Miso is a Hungarian dairy company which has the largest dairy plant in Central Europe found in Szeged. They make cottage cheese, regular cheese, cream, butter, buttery cream, curd cheese bar, kefir, yogurt, sour cream, coffee, milk, and flavored milk, including my personal favorite of theirs, their chocolate milk. It is the best liquid I've ever consumed on this trip, and keep in mind, I fell in love with Spezi earlier in Germany, and I was legally allowed to drink an alcohol. It might be the best liquid I've ever drank in my entire life. Speaking of which, this video is also not sponsored by Miso, sadly, despite me trying numerous times at the beginning of making this vlog by reaching out to them. The next day, it was rainy, some beautifully dreary day, so I attempted to escape it, to run away from my problems, which always works out perfectly for me and is very mentally healthy to do. So I went on a day trip to Pace, the 5th largest city in Hungary, because there was a university I was thinking of going to. However, it was closed because it was a weekend and I didn't end up wanting to do that program anyway. Pace was originally founded by the Romans in the 2nd century, and over the years it was taken over by the Holy Roman Empire, the Ottoman Empire, and Yugoslavia. In 1998, the city was granted the title of City for Peace, and in 2010 it was selected to be one of the European capitals of culture, along with Essen and Istanbul. I got to Pace at around noon, the rain following me from Budapest. It was nice and calm there. It felt like a hometown, not mine, and I felt almost intrusive walking through the city. It was like shopping at a grocery store on a road trip or on a vacation, or trying to get an inside joke. Other than the college, the city only had a few main attractions, a church, a Roman burial ground, and a mosque. I walked through the center before finding the smaller family restaurant off to the side called Vierka. I sat at a table near the bar and the waitress spoke broken English, only a few words. I got this hearty goulash with a bread basket with some aviar. Afterwards, I just wandered around. I found this huge stuffed animal advertising some sort of shop nearby and ended up finding a magnet for a souvenir from here as the rain continued on. I kept on thinking that I was so lucky and how much I was going to miss all of this. Exploring new cities, trying new things, everything being so photogenic and so old, baked with so much history in every single building. I then made my way up to the Pace Cathedral, my final church on this trip, number 12. St. Peter and St. Paul's Cathedral Basilica, or more commonly called Pace's Cathedral, was originally founded by the Romans in the 4th century. However, it was completely redone by Stefan I of Hungary. It was almost completely empty when I was there. There were only a handful of people who were there praying, and I was left alone in some of these rooms with these breathtakingly ancient images of these holy men. And of course, I walked up to see the red roofs from above. Then I made my way to the early Christian necropolis, one of the oldest and most significant Roman Christian burial grounds outside of Italy, dating back to the 1st century when Romans expanded and took Pace as part of the empire. Now for a montage over some old bones. If only I had a song for this. Oh wait!
No!
the downtown Candomas Church of the Blessed Virgin Mary, formerly known as the Mosque of Pasha Kasim, was originally built during the Ottoman conquest of Hungary in the second part of the 16th century. It was there until the Ottomans were driven out, and the mosque was then converted into a Roman Catholic church. Being inside felt so wrong and beautiful and conflicted. It was just so fascinating. I mean, a Catholic church with the Quran written on its walls, a mosque dedicated to worshiping the Virgin Mary. It was a divine dichotomy. I booked the 5:30 to Budapest earlier, so with an hour left, I walked back to the train station, stopping at an inner spar to get some snacks. Then I ran to the train station just to realize it was the wrong one, meaning that there was only one more train left, the one at 7:04. The last train to Budapest.
Last train to San Fernando. Last train to San Fernando. If you miss this one, you'll never get another one. Be-de-de-de-bum-bum to San Fernando. Last night I met my sweet Dorothy. She said tomorrow I'll join a sweet matrimony. But if you act all right, oh, you can take me out tonight. We could wine and dine and get back in time for the last train.
I woke up at 5:30 with the full intention of going to see Fisherman's Bastion at sunrise, but I was exhausted from the day before and actually wanted to enjoy my last day exploring before I left for Munich tomorrow and hopped on a flight the next one. So I went to a breakfast spot and got a flavorless pumpkin spice latte along with some stuffed French toast that had ham and cheese in it. Then I began to make my way to the Buddhist side of Budapest, stopping to admire everything. The sun trying to peek its way through the sky, trying its best to illuminate my way as I walked, seeing Budavari Palota, or Buddha Castle, and finally getting a shot of these really cool yellow velamos. I then crossed the bridge and made my way to the funicular, which took me to the top of Buddha, specifically the castle quarter. This area was beautiful. There was just these stunning and beautiful monuments and buildings and these corduroy trees.
My house in Budapest, my hidden treasure chest, golden grand piano, my beauty focus, me or you. Ooh, you, ooh, I'd leave it all. My acres of a land I've achieved, it may be hard for you to stop and believe, but for you, ooh, you, ooh, I'd leave it all.
After exploring the castle grounds, I found myself at Dracula's Labyrinth, where the inspiration for Bram Stoker's Dracula, Vlad the Impaler, was imprisoned for a time. And according to my grandfather, we are related. You see, my mother's maiden name is Draculic, and that side is ethnically Serbian. Serbia borders Romania, where Vlad the Impaler was born. Also, the name Draculic means son of Dracul, and Dracul was Viman's last name. Also, it is sometimes spelled with a K, like how our name is spelled. So, this is not just some random attraction to me. It is also a family reunion. Cue the disco music.
No vampires remain in Romania.
I am not your Dracula Spectacular. This is not your weekend in Vegas. This is not your selfie obscura. I am not your tour guide of Barry. This is not West Hollywood on Thursday. I am not your object to art. I am not your sepia heyday. This is not the moment we part.
No vampires remain in Romania. No vampires remain in Romania.
Don't
then, after the Jakulik family reunion, I went to the Gold Barrel instead of the traditional Golden Corral, which the Jakuliks normally go to. And with a view of St. Matthias Church, I enjoyed some delicious but expensive chicken paprikash. St. Matthias Church was built in 1015 and is also known as the Church of Assumption of the Buddha Castle, or the Church of Coronation of Buddha, because two kings were actually crowned within its walls. It is, checking my notes here, Karl I and... Why is he everywhere? So, out of spite, and also because the line was getting super long and it was super expensive to go inside of a church, I didn't go. So instead I found a free attraction instead, this cursed statue of a Kurtoskalach right outside. And for some Anyway, welcome back to the MGM Pictures YouTube channel, where we're currently at the epic Hashlas Basta, our Fisherman's Bastion. Sorry for being a YouTuber. Anyway, Fisherman's Bastion is, quote, the most important tourist attraction in Budapest. And you could definitely tell, it was infested with tourists. In every crevice of the wall, there was someone taking a picture, which is just ridiculous and insane. I mean, who would want a cute photo of themselves with the backdrop of the entirety of Pest with these beautiful neo-Romanesque terraces? It would be ridiculous. And no, I'm not jealous. I didn't want a photo anyway. But like, for real, this spot was really cool to check out, and I probably should have came earlier. Also, there's a spot where you have to pay to go on the Bastion, but if you go a little to the left, there's a spot that is free, I think. Then I took the long way back to my hostel, facing west. It was calmer and very beautiful, and I know it was just houses and like a hill as the leaves died, but it was still beautiful. And not to sound pretentious, but I called it, quote, the finest melancholy in my journal, which I think kind of fits. The last days of a trip tend to do that, too. The sun was ducking in and out of the sky. I was trying to admire everything, to ingrain everything into my mind, trying not to photograph or video as much as I did, and I got the joys of watching other people do it. Eventually, I made it back to my hostel. After a break, I went to get something to eat. I wanted to go back to Simsla, but I wanted a new experience. So I went to this very touristy restaurant, but I ran into this protest. I have no clue what it was about. At the restaurant, I had my last legal drink, at least for a while, and a very overpriced, but halfway decent stew. Then I tried to get another chocolate milk from Tesco, but it was closed on Sundays. So instead I went to a train station and grabbed a burnt Kurtoskalach. I ate it and it was mid. Then I had to start packing as I had a long day ahead of me tomorrow. I had to get up early to get road snacks, catch the 8:40 to Vienna, and then the 12:28 to Munich so that I could get on my flight to Charlotte the next day. So I folded and packed in this cute little montage. Surya Puriya Pili Biri Buddha, Surya Puriya Pili Biri Buddha, Surya Puriya Pili Biri Buddha, Dubin Ta Bara Ta Ta Ta. Surya Puriya Pili Biri Buddha, Surya Puriya Pili Biri Buddha, Surya Puriya Pili Biri Buddha, Dubin Ta Bara Ta Ta Ta. I looked at the souvenirs that I got from this trip, most of them being patches from my jacket, and one of them ended up getting lost, the Nuremberg one. And also I looked at the souvenirs that I got from my family and friends before packing them tight and heading off for bed. On my final day in Budapest and my penultimate day on the trip, I woke up at the ungodly hour of 5:30 in the morning. I wandered around my hostel and took this video of the living room because it was empty and right next to my room, and it was really, really cool. Legitimately, the Lavender Circus Hostel has been one of the best that I've been to, and I would definitely recommend it if you were ever planning on visiting Budapest. Then, I went out onto the early streets of some European city at an ungodly hour, trying to find somewhere to eat. Ending it like how it began, I guess. However, it being 6 now was not the only thing working against me, but also it was a Hungarian holiday, Revolution Memorial Day, and almost all the shops were closed. Except this small one, where I picked up some breakfast, including everybody's favorite brand of Hungarian chocolate milk, Mizos. I ate breakfast by the Danube River as the rest of the city slept. Then I made my way back to my hostel. Before I left, I sat for a moment, and I reflected on this amazing trip that I was so lucky to be able to go on. To leave America alone, to hike up fairy tale castles and watch clockwork figurines, to read Kafka, learn about communism in a city affected by it, and see a chapel made of Catholic skulls, to find my best friend to connect with my culture and see a UFO, and lastly, to be hungry in Hungary. Thank you all for watching, and I'll see you when I see you. Don't be a stranger. This is MJ, signing off.
I'm sitting in the railway station, got a ticket for my destination. On a tour of one night stands, my suitcase and guitar in hand, and every stop is neatly planned for a poet and a one-man band. Homeward bound, I wish I was. Thoughts escaping home, where my music's playing home, where my love lies waiting silently for me. Every day is an endless stream of cigarettes and magazines. And each town looks the same to me, the movies and the factories, and every stranger's face I see reminds me that I long to be homeward bound. I wish I was homeward bound. Home, where my thoughts are escaping. Home, where my music's playing. Home, where my love lies waiting silently. Tonight I'll sing my songs again, I'll play the game and pretend. But all my words come back to me in shades of mediocrity, like emptiness and harmony. I need someone to comfort me. Homeward bound, I wish I was home. Thoughts escaping home, where my music's playing home, where my love lies waiting silently for me, silently for me.
And now, folks, it's time to say goodnight. We sincerely appreciate your patronage and hope we've succeeded in bringing you an enjoyable evening of entertainment. Please drive home carefully and come back again soon. Good night.